Sandy kicked us off with yesterday about, you know, where did music fixed to the page come from? And that this is quite a challenge to do in 45 minutes. And I kind of, and specifically about looking at what individual people had wanted to communicate via marks on a page.
Yeah.
Well, this here is, and I'm see if I can pronounce it properly, the Oxyrhynchus hymn found, and it's called the Oxyrhynchus hymn merely because it was found at Oxyrhynchus in Egypt. And it's a 3rd century AD papyrus manuscript.
And, wow.
And it has hieroglyphics on it. And it's one of the very first, I mean, there may be more, but people, the archaeologists haven't found them. This is the first known instance of marks put down by an individual onto a medium that allows other people to see and possibly understand what it is that they want to communicate. All these hieroglyphics, these neumes, mean something to the people of the time. But those neumes continued in terms of, I mean, why do we have something written down on a piece of paper or stone or wood or whatever it is? And the purpose of that is to give someone else the chance of seeing what the original person's idea is that they want to communicate, whether it's a song or a poem or a story or an official document or whatever. It's passing stuff on.
Yes, pass it on.
The illuminated manuscripts with and this
coming. Beautiful.
Bernard, I think, mentioned Charlemagne the other day, and I can't remember under what circumstances he talked about Charlemagne. But Charlemagne, 747 to 814, so I'm not being posy, I wrote it down to make sure, but was the Holy Roman Emperor, and he was instrumental in wanting to control and consolidate what was being sung in monasteries across the Christian world. And the original idea was, I mean, here we have an example of what's called plain chant. And if we look at it, we can clearly see that there are pitches that go up and down and around. And the manuscript itself illuminated because it's being made to feel special. And each of these written things, there's no printing here. The printing press doesn't come in until the 1400s, sometime much time later. You all know that. But it was making something special and communicating these ideas to try and regulate what was sung in the churches and the psalms taken from the Bible, and the psalms or hymns and passed across to many other places. And that was all done by copying, where the one monk, to be able to share it with another monk, there's no photostat machine or photocopying in the corner. He doesn't press a button. He's got to write it out. But at that particular time as well, the writing out was a celebratory process. It wasn't just scribble something down. It had to draw you in and look good and make you feel good. And you're dealing with the word of God in the belief of the time. Here, this is the modern version of what we're looking at, and they're the five lines that we see, okay? And you've got A note, da da ya, da 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 da. But there's no definition of tempo.
No.
There's no definition of what the speed is, the duration of the pitches.
Yes.
And
how long the notes last.
Yeah, and that was interpreted by the individual. Now here's an ordo virtuum. This is again Hildegard de Bingen. Now this is an opera.
Oh, it's beautiful.
And it's a handwritten opera.
It is lovely.
Hildegard lived between 1098 and 1179. And Didisberg in eastern Germany, well, near the modern split between Austria and Germany, and she was not just an abbess, but was a doctor, was a scientist, was dealt a great deal of time about the condition of women. And the bodily condition of women and the political and social. But this particular piece was an opera written for a visiting abbess, and they performed it to the abbess. Now, if we look at it, the red lines indicate the differences between one part of it and the next, so that you have here is above. On the left-hand side, those neumes, the hieroglyphics at the top, are indicating the pitch of to be sung with the words underneath. But the red lines give you the differences between one process and then the following. So you're not going across to the right, you're going between the red lines and follow through. So it's a bit like... Right. Pagination, the separation of ideas and where it all goes. So, and Macho was writing around the 1300 to 1377, and here's the neumes on the page of the plain chant and how it's sung at the time, and the duration of the notes developed through an understanding and a replication of singing this. So this is what it sounded like back then. Going up and down. And that means the dot indicates a stop. Comes to where we diverted from monophily, that single line sung by everybody, to polyphony, which means lots of different parts going on. Now here's where it changes, and we don't have accessible online at the moment the original score of this. So this is a modern interpretation. So the Kyrie. All four voices together. Okay, so they're following the path with one syllable, which is the Greek Kyrie. Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Lord have mercy on us, Christ have mercy on us. And that was, I'm sure I don't need to explain that bit of it to us all. But what Machaut was doing was that he was allowing the original materials that were handed round to all these various places over the centuries before him to still exist, but then in a way do a variation on them, but in the manner that he understood at the time, that allowed his markings on the page to be passed to lots of other people to do the same kind of thing. So, but because the monks in the monasteries had learnt to read, had learnt to decipher the neumes, the graphics on the page, they could do that. This doesn't negate at all the music that continued in the general public in terms of what they played and what they heard and what they shared. But it wasn't as today with rock music or pop music. It's rarely written down. It's only written down to register something or for someone else to pick it up when they have the ability to play it. But it's not necessary. Today we have CDs and we have radio, we have television, so we can hear things just the same as in the streets or the churches or wherever people performed these things. And if you get hooked enough, you learn something, but you don't need to read it. But the writing of music was all to do with one person's idea being passed off to other people's ideas. Now, we're going to go to people were talking about the delightful Johann Sebastian Bach the other day. And I know that Gordon was talking about the double violin concerto that I think some of you know and love, as do I. Now, here's the original manuscript of the violin concerto, and got lots of blank pages first. So here we go, the original. Now, Johann Sebastian wrote hundreds of pieces, and you can see this is in ink. So his precision of what he hears, you can see here at the beginning, ya ba 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 bum bum ba da di da 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 bum 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 ba ba ya da 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 da. And I kept it just so that you could see the thing. Now, here is, there's no indication of tempo. There's no indication of dynamic. There's no indication of whether it's loud or soft or whether it's extremely fast or not. You have, and there's Mr. Bach's, Johann's hand. This is all handwritten. That's his signature above there. And underneath, the very, very important thing, the basso. And you can see little figures. There's a six, there's a two, there's a seven, there's a 9-4, an 8-2. And as Bach wrote this, and he doesn't have a keyboard next to him to check what he's writing, he hears it in his head. And what he hears in his head through his own experience of writing all the time, the pitches. And Jackie, you asked the question about the four lines and the five lines. It's just an adaptation of the minutiae of what you hear. That plain chant going up and down doesn't give us a precise notion of what the pitch is. Here we do have, and at some point that we haven't been able to pinpoint exactly when, a fifth line was added so that we could show the passage of a scale. Ya ba 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 ba. You know, seven pitches of tonal music. And then when you go above it, you add your own staves, your own lines, ledger lines, and you add ledger lines below. Now, here below, we can see there's an extra line added at 1, 2, 3, the third bar in the violi and the basses as well. But these figures are also telling us, a bit like the, I'm going to show you a similar page from something of the kind of stuff that in my own scores. A jazz player today will be given a chord chart that says C, G7, A minor 7, D minor, or whatever. And that tells them what chordal inversion to play, what chord they actually play. And what the a bit like, here we go, dun, 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 dun. So if I see a C, I'll play, and if I see a G, I'll play, or an A minor, or a D, or an E minor, but the harmony is my choice. So there's no piece of music that's telling me whether I'm playing an E at the bottom, or a B, or an E, or a G, all the way up. Whereas here, Bach is telling the player, if there's a six, you also include the note, the pitch, a sixth above that note. And if you have a seven, it's a seventh above that note. Da, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six. No, it doesn't quite work, does it? Because there's another. Just a minute. One, do, 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 da, 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 that's the seventh. But they know it's a seventh flat. I'm not going to draw us into harmony lessons either. But it's positions of where the chords come. Now the here is the print of the same thing, and this was the first printed version of Bach's score, and it says here that we are nous n'avons pu nous servir pour rédiger ce concert. We've organized this to help you with this concert that you're about to hear, and you will find this in the library in Berlin. And it's been written out from the handwritten score of Bach himself. So this is one of the first printed versions of that score. Now we can see the same thing, but this time it has vivace, which means fast, energetic, full of life. So the player then decides, okay, it's got to be fast, it's got to be energetic, it's got to be full of life. And we can see here, ya ba 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 bum 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 bum. But what they've done underneath is to remove Bach's figured bass, because that figured bass allowed the player, especially a keyboard player who is doing the continuo, the either at the continuo on the organ or on a harpsichord or a clavichord at the time, to add their own harmonies, given that you've got the bom 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 ya ba 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 ba, etc. etc. So that's what the keyboard player of today would be adding. Here's where's double Bach? Here's Mr. Menuhin and Mr. Oistrakh from 1961 playing the opening part of this. Come on, lads, get going. There you go. Now, they're following that. I'm sorry to keep stopping it, but they're following.
Marvelous.
Yeah, they're following the pitches that are on the page in a particular way. Now that tempo is chosen by the conductor and the performers, the tempo that they want to play. Bach is not telling them, apart from the word that's been passed down, vivace, which is an assumption on the part of the printer anyway. Now, just think about that. Ya ba 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 bum bum, one and two and three and four. And now here's Sophie Mutter and Nancy Zhou with the same piece, but listen to the tempo. Now, they're handing on from one to the other. Now, remember, this little talk here is about how music is written down and communicating. I'd love to stay with these pieces because they're beautiful. They're phenomenal things. But going back to the idea of that communication process. Now, if we go to Barbara Strozzi. Now, she was a real 1619 to 1677. And she was thought of as the sexiest woman alive by performers and writers. And her writing, her materials are very sensuous. Oh. Still Barbara Strozzi. Yeah, the accompaniment is from the instruments of the time, the symphonium, which was that a bit like a harmonium, but it was called the symphonium. The bass viol, precursor of the cello, and the guitarum, which is, as the term says, and it's also a tenor theorbo, multi-strung, and has resonating strings as well. So not only what the player is playing, but the reverberance effect across to the strings that he's playing on. So it always has to be in the same key, because if he's changing key, then he's got to change the resonating strings. But again, it's down to the words and this particular song, which was the one I showed the writing of. So. One of these days, I will go through Barbara Strozzi's stuff, because although you know, I say she was very raunchy lady and very raunchy stuff. It's finding the right things to play for us. The Overture of Don Giovanni. Now, Mozart wrote this overnight before the first performance of Don Giovanni back in the late, I think it was 1790. He died in 1791. And this manuscript he wrote overnight. Now, here you have one page. Then you go to the next page, and then another page, and another page, and another page, and another page. And it's a 4.5 minute overture that he wrote overnight with the copyists next to him, farming the pages across to the copyists as he wrote. Now, okay, there's two things going on here. He has no keyboard or anything to verify his pitches. The guy is so fixated on what he's writing. He knows exactly the pitches he wants. There's no corrections. There's the occasional scribbling out. But as he passes a page across to a copyist, he's already abdicated his own possibility of going back and changing something. So he's got firmly in his head what the opera materials are. So his memory is working as well. He doesn't have the time to refer back to other things that he's written. Now, Mozart, being the consummate, skilled composer that he was, he knew exactly what he wanted and how he wanted to get there. Now, have a look at this, because here is Mozart at the age of 11. In London. And this is one of his first symphonies that he wrote.
Amazing.
It says here, Symphonia. But what we have, we don't have a score because he didn't write a score. What he wrote were the parts. He went straight to the parts. He didn't write a score. So he has in his head already the individual voicings that he wants. Now, here's the figured bass, as I was talking about earlier. 6-4 gives him the harmony, which here's our basses underneath the F, and it's going yom bom 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 bom. You can see in this very first bar there are 8 marks, 8 quavers, and they're going yom bom 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 bom. The next bar has minims with a line through it. So it's a shortcut. It's exactly the same as the first bar, except the composer is taking a shortcut. So he doesn't have to keep writing out all those notes, which are the same notes all the time. So if we went from the first bar, yum, bum, 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 second bar, dum, 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 third bar, dum, 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 fourth bar, yum, bum, bum, then fifth bar, bum, 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 bum. But we know that they're the same notes. And then this, the next bar on where we have notes pitched, bar, ya, ba, 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 bum, ba, ba, bum, 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 ba, bum. Now, the 11-year-old Wolfgang is writing this from memory as he goes along to make sure, because he doesn't have time to write out the score afterwards to give to the players. Here's the first violin part. He wrote the bass part first because that bass part gives him from his memory and the basis of everything and the harmony above. Now here we have the first violin part, and there's quite a lot of markings that Bach didn't have. FP means forte piano, so that the player goes da 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 dum 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 badum bam badum. So it's loud, soft, loud followed immediately by soft. Now the graphic on the page tells us that, and underneath he's got allegro assai. And allegro assai means fast enough. Don't go too fast, but don't go too slow. Just nicely, you know, it's a bit like the porridge of the three bears. Just not too hot, not too cold, just nice. And that's what allegro assai means. And you've got other markings in here as we go down. There's a place where you've got double bar lines with lots of other black bits. And that means a repeat. So you go back to the top and you can see lines. If you look at 1, 2, 3, the third bar along, there's a slur above the notes. And that's telling the violinist that you do it with one movement. You don't go yata down up. You go da-ya, da, dia, da, dia, da. Because Mozart knows that the movement of the bow is important to tell the players how to play the, because it changes the nature of the music. And that's how we get the player to play what we want to do. So, and then there's violins too. Now, it's astounding that he wrote at the age of 11, this piece and many other pieces without reference to anything other than his own mind. Now, when you come to Beethoven, here's his seventh symphony. And I want to go to page 47 because this shows us, okay, dum bum 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 down here at the bottom here, and we can clearly see the what Beethoven's intention is. There's no doubt. It again, it's ink on the page. He's already been out walking around as he did with his notebooks, scribbling stuff out. But when he comes to the score, he's not sat at a piano. He's writing down what exactly it is that he wants. And it's clear on the page what it is that he wants. And here we have slurs and dots under the notes, which tell the player that although you play it with the bow in the right, in the same direction, you're going to stop the sound as you go along. Da, dun, dun, da, dun, dun, da, 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 dum, dum, da, da, ya, ba, ba, ya, da, di, da, dum. And the graphic is very clear as to what's intended. And this is before deafness descended on him to a great extent. He was getting deaf anyway, but his vision and his perception was very clear as to what it is he wanted to communicate. But when you come to Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, when he was completely deaf, he couldn't hear, even though he conducted part of the first performance, he had no idea what he was actually hearing, apart from what his body was receiving from the point of view of the vibration of the players. But the manuscript is very difficult to work out exactly what it is that he wishes, apart from this area here, where we can see the minims, two beats that are tied across all the time. Now, let me just get you to where the famous tune comes in, and it's way, way further on, towards the end. Now, you see, here in the manuscript, the assumption was that he got very frustrated with whether his exactly what he wanted to have. The red marks are added by his student who jumped in to help him conduct at the beginning, and he put those marks in to remind him. Fortissimo means very loud, double F, very loud. So again, we're looking at the way in which a composer communicates his ideas. Now, his copyist had to interpret what it was that he'd put on the page. So, and there are some letters from Beethoven stating that this bloody man kept interrupting me, asking me, did I mean this? Did I mean that? Of course I meant that. the man's blind, he can't tell, he can't see. And he got very angry with him, but they're very straightforward questions. And any copyist to isolate each of the individual parts, as Mozart did in his K223 symphony at the age of 11, knew that the part given to the player allowed the player to play exactly what he wanted accurately. So the part has to be clear. Now, with these, the parts are not clear, but someone has to copy them to make them clear. And you can have the best players under the sun, but if you don't have a part they can play, you don't have a performance.
Yeah.
So anyway, there's that. Now we come to the dear Gustav Mahler, dear Gussie, and his well-known Adagietto that was used in Death in Venice, the film Death in Venice. And here we have, and the piece was written for Alma, his wife, but his lover before his wife. And at this time, he'd realized that she was having an affair with Grotius, the architect. And Mahler was 25 years older than Alma. And here we have this very, very clearly marked on the page, the harp, sehr langsam, very slow. But you have an adaptation of how to, and sorry, an increase in marks on the page to control how and where you're going. The speed of something, very slow. But then we've got molto ritardando. Ritardando means hold back. And then you have a tempo in the third bar, molto adagio. So get back to tempo, very slow at the beginning. Second bar, hold back a bit. The next bar, back to the original tempo at the beginning, but he's underlining molto adagio. So don't rush ahead of yourself, harpist. Don't rush ahead of yourself. Bom, 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 bom. The triplets that are going down. What's interesting here as well is that these manuscripts are not just indications to the player. It's a diary. It's part of the way in which the composer is thinking and feeling at the time. Mahler, as he was writing this piece, knew that his marriage was doomed, and it passed over so many years through that process. And we can assume that because never before has he used one page for one system, because he's not sure whether he's going to add other instruments as he goes along. The Adagietto movement is for strings and harp only. And so the next page again has only the strings and the harp, but there are blank staves above and blank staves below. He's not sure as he's writing it, because he's writing from the gut. And he's writing here, always keep going, always stay together, don't overplay anything. It's almost as if he's talking to himself as he's going along. He doesn't want to hide anything from the player, from himself. And where we have here the little lines marked above the celli, underneath, if you count down from the bar, from the staves that are marked, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and you've got 7 staves altogether, those marks on the celli, he wants the celli to play out. Da di 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 da 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 ya. And he's got above that with the violas, molto, stay with the sound, let the sound ring, don't draw back. And he's got crescendi, those lines that look, we call hairpins, because they look like hairpins that you put in. And he's got piano with a crescendo. And then the next note with a crescendo. But the player knows that he's not wanting it to go da da da. He knows the, or she knows that it's da di da da. Back, and the gosh, I'm getting all emotional about this. It's because that's exactly what it is. He's showing the emotion on the page as he's writing. And one of his last symphonies, Symphony number 8, the Symphony of 1000, this is his original score, but it starts off with the Veni Viato Spiritus. Let's see if I can find it. Where's it gone? Oh no, I think it's on somewhere else. Here we have the organ and piano, strings above, and you've got Folies Werk, the whole thing. Open the whole thing up, open all the stops out and just whack it. Fortissimo, double F, give it molto welly is what he's saying. And then the choir comes in, Veni, Veni Creator Spiritus, bum, bum, ba, bum. And you've got 4-4, meaning 1, 2, 3, 4, Veni, and then 3-4, Veni Creator, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's clear on the page exactly what he wants. Pesante, heavy, make it really resonate. And you've got trumpets and trombones and palche, timpani, underneath. Bam, bam, ba, bam, bam. And tempo primo. So pesante means pull it back, make it heavy. Then back to the original tempo. Here at the top, you have woodwind the on the corner, flute, flauti, oboe, and the clarinets. And and you can see with the lines what's intended. So we go through and we go through, and but he's always got his parts with staves above and below that are open for him to add things. Here he's got tubular bells that he's put in, but he's also scrubbed out one of the bars, this bottom one here. The strings above are going ya da da da. You can see lines on the played part as well, which means double the notes. Da 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 da. A bit like Mozart earlier. He doesn't have to write out the repeated note. He's got to give himself space because he's already hand-drawn the bar lines before he's filled them out, so that he doesn't have room to then fill out. And here's some crossings out where his voicings ended up not being the voicings that he wanted, but the pitches are fairly clear. He's writing in ink. And when Mahler was writing, he had access to a piano, but he never went to the piano while he was writing. He went to the piano after he had spent a day writing, just to confirm what it was that he wrote. I want to show you this, because here we come to Ravel, and Ravel's Bolero, and a very clear page, and we can see, if you look down from the top left-hand corner, go down, you can see bis, which means blank, and then underneath it is the tenor drum, yum ta da da dum dum bum bum, yum ta da da dum ta da 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 dum ta da da dum, two bars. Then the next two bars, you can see a line with two dots on either side. What that means is, a bit like Mozart, not having to write everything out, so that you can write at fever pitch, you can keep going. It means play exactly the same two bars all the time. And you can see it's repeated. You've got the first two bars, then the player knows the next two bars are the same. Then the next two bars are the same. Next two bars are the same. And the same down below, where pizzicato, celli and basses are playing two bars and then playing the same two bars and again and again. And what the copyist would do for the players so that they could count, you would then copy above. That's the first two bars, one, second two bars, two, second two bars, three, second two bars, four, and so on and so on. And here's the tune at the top. Etc., etc. Now, this score is perfectly legible, perfectly easily transferable to the copyist, but Ravel copied the parts out himself. He never trusted a copyist to do it for him. He took his time. And that's the precision of the pitches. He didn't particularly like Bolero because he felt that it was his least inventive piece. Now, we know differently, but he didn't want that. Now, I want to finish with this very quickly because I want to go back to, with a bit of fun, our Bach double violin concerto, which I know you love, Gordon, and lots of other people love as well. Right. El Sistema, which has been going around the world for kids, teaching them about orchestral players and the audiences. And we did many masterclasses, so I thought one last one would be fun. So here we go. And...
try to relax your bow arm. Like. Oh my God. Good thing you became a conductor. So let's try it again. Let's just start.
Now watch what happens from here. I'm going to leave it going for a few minutes. It's really good. Thank you. I'm going to stop there. I mean, it's fabulous.
Oh, that was fabulous.
Absolutely.
I really enjoyed that.
We're now midday, and I've tried to cram the evolution of the writing of music into an hour, but...
Did a fantastic job.
It was brilliant, yes.
Brilliant.
Thank you. And it's... No, I well... I suppose it passes over a bit of the enthusiasm I have in terms of, you know, handwriting stuff, and you live the thing that you write. It's not just a graphic. I mean, as Gray writes his poems, the words, you live those words, you feel those things. It's not just a, you know, we can forget that today when, or rather we can often lose that view when we're working through computers. Even though I use the Sibelius software, the Sibelius software doesn't do it for me. It's still an electronic pencil. I have to make every mark on the stave that is the idea in my head, just as the word, Gray, that you write, your pencil, or you type in, or any of us writing or whatever, we are in touch with the thing we do. So...
Thank you.
It's the humanity of it.
Thank you, Bill. That was
marvelous.
Brilliant.
Wonderful. Absolute joy.
Hey, folks, look, I hope you have a good day. Thank you for staying.
Thank you, Bill.
Great.
Thank you.
You'll need to put your feet up and have a rest now.
Yes, absolutely.
I've got more stuff to do now. I've got a Étoile d'Imoi.
Oh.
Étoile d'Imoi. I'll just very quickly show it to you because it's we're doing Étoile d'Imoi is Étoile d'Imoi, the music of Michel Hestolte. We're recording kids in Freiburg with the
oh good grief
with the orchestra there in Prague for a Christmas release, and Jerome Stern sent me this, and we're back to hieroglyphics on a page and getting those sorted. And one of the other songs is Pevelamine in the Swiss dialect. And no yitan du tre tre danno. And you've got to just do it. Oh gosh, I'm showing off now. Shut up, Colin. Right, okay.
No.
It's bye bye time.
It's bye bye time. Lovely to see you.
Bill.
See you tomorrow. Bill.
See you tomorrow.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye bye.